heat tolerance and the identifications of the molecular markers for the drought resistance in the rice. As well as he also achieved the number of awards as well as the fellowships also. In 2011 to 2015, he achieved the awards, the Felix Trust PhD scholarships, as well as in the 2007 to 2009, he also get the fellowships from the JNU DBT, MSc Biotechnology, as well as he also awarded by the multiple travel grants from the various professional societies, like International Bio-Iron Society's Travel Bursary Award, as well as the Society for the Experimental Biology, the Company of the Biologist Travel Fund. So these are the number of the achievements. So today we will share his experience. So I request to Salunke sir, please share your success story as well as your research also with us.
Thank you, Saritama, for this nice introduction. And I'm also grateful to our society president, Dr. A.M. Deshmukh sir. Actually, it is a very nice thing for me to come in contact with Deshmukh sir and then get in touch and continue with these opportunities. Indeed, I'm very glad to have this opportunity to interact with this like young students, and maybe because I was some time back in your stage looking for these opportunities, these informations. As you have already heard from Sarita ma'am, what I've been there for, and I basically we can do like things that are mainly, I assume you, most of you would be looking for how to get abroad, specifically UK in today's session, for your higher education or scholarships. And maybe I can think of three parts, like three objectives. First would be like, first priority would be how to get there. And then comes the second part, once you get there, what exactly do there, what to expect there, or maybe how you can get the best of the opportunity. And maybe in case if you have further questions, what you do after finishing your like scholarship or higher education there, do you need to stay there or come back? Probably these kind of the three phases we can talk about. And not necessarily we have to talk about just only three phases. You can ask any other questions, whatever comes to your mind.
Sir, we want this just first information, how you achieved such type of the fellowships, and which type of the efforts we required in this field. If we require the fellowships, achieve the fellowships or the awards, then which type of the efforts we should do?
Definitely. I will start with the probably my journey where I started to the UK, not going much into the background. Probably you already know, like when you want to start for abroad applications, it is a time-taking process. It doesn't happen very sharply, like you come to know about the new notification of the admission process and you apply straight away. You need to have a timed target, like probably at least minimum 6 months, a year ahead, you should start the process. So in brief, when I started, I applied. Generally, I would say like steps how you would go for this process is, if you want to go for abroad higher education, many important parts in this process are securing an admission to the desired university or maybe your targeted lab or a chosen professor. Another part is most important is your funding, of finance, because I assume most of the people you might be knowing a small bit, so maybe much more. If I'm going again with known things, maybe you can raise a hand and stop me. It should be fine. We can avoid those things. So basically, most important factor comes is your finance, because compared to India, when you go abroad, specifically in UK, if you know about the UK currency, so it would be huge amount of money to spend on. So it is very expensive part. So most important factor I consider is the finance. So usually it is very rare. Most of the students, we can't afford ourselves. So most important emphasis I will give on the scholarships. And so basically going through the scholarship, there are also various types of scholarship where you can have the full sponsors, partial scholarships, or you have to make a blanket of scholarships, like combining two, three different and achieve your financial target. So going back to the major points is securing the admission Probably, I don't think if you are doing very good student, good scores in your academics and you have a good CV, probably these days securing admission in the international universities wouldn't be a very big challenge. Although you go into the details as you have more questions, like what are the details about this scholarship or maybe the admission process, you have to decide, are you qualified for the particular course? Do you meet the eligibility requirement of the individual university? And so in this case, if I say generally, mostly if you want to go for a master's course, upper second class undergraduate degree from India would be fine to be eligible for the master's course. If you're going for the PhD, they would like to have a master's degree into the relevant field where you are applying for the PhD. And apart from this academic eligibilities, they also need to have the English proficiency. So most of the you people might know, like there might be requirement for like TOEFL, GRE, IELTS. Mostly for the UK, they prefer to have an IELTS score. So IELTS scores is generally in the biological sciences, they require an overall score of 6.5 as well as into the individual sectors like reading, writing, and every part. So these will be the another part. So this is the thing. And sometimes these days, luckily this year, like in 2020 or coming year 2021, there would be exemption from this English language requirements. Maybe they can exempt you from having a specific score into these exams or these things. And you can take an advantage, probably there are alternatives. These days it has become very strict because of the immigration rules. They want, you must have this like an international at-pass course for the visa purposes. But earlier, years back, like 5-7 years before, even if you have an your undergraduate or postgraduate degree with the medium of instruction in English, that would have been even acceptable thing for your English proficiency. But that case, it would come with your sponsor university. If they evaluate your English proficiency and they recommend to the visa immigrations, like they have evaluated your proficiency and they're happy with your English levels, then it works. So maybe this year, immediately, if somebody is planning to apply, these kind of alternatives might help them to get through without having this IELTS exam or any other English requirements.
My question is there, sir.
Yes, sir, sure, please.
What was your research topic in reading? What is the scope in that topic to Indian students?
Okay, so my research topic was like a relationship, like a molecular genetic analysis of iron transport systems in pathogenic bacteria and its role in the pathogenicity of that bacteria. So the bacteria was E. coli 157, that is a pathologic enterohemorrhagic bacteria, pathogenic bacteria, you know. And the reason to have specifically chosen this topic, why I wanted to see the specifically ion transport system, because there are so many ion transport system, and because we know for pathogenic bacteria, so probably here I also put some insight or light onto the, when you write a proposal for a PhD or something, there comes like, what is your important question, why it is of interest, and why is it important, and in addition, how it is builds on any previous work. So basically the lab I was visiting works on the iron metabolism in the bacteria. So already they have been working into all the ferric ion transport systems. But one of the previous PhD student had some preliminary results or indications that this very specific ferrous ion transport system in this bacteria was only functional in the pathogenic strain. And it was cryptic, like kind of functional into the unpathogenic or commensal bacterias. There was an interest specifically at this point, like, is this specific system giving any specific advantage to only pathogenic bacteria for their survival or to the infection? And probably looking into this way, if we could identify the link of this transport system into any specific conditions, we can utilize those conditions to deal with this pathogenicity of the bacteria.
So there is one question from the student side. There is a Malik Rehan, and he told, sir, if I complete my master's in India and I want to my PhD in UK, what should I do for this? And which universities are the best for studying the microbiology?
Okay, so the first thing I would say, like here you already have done your master's or already has he finished his master's and already applying for this process. So regardless, whatever stage he is, first thing to choose the universities for any students, this is actually a very important question or maybe a very confusion or dilemma also in many students' mind, like how to choose the university. There was one way earlier we used to like see the overall ranking of the universities, like Times Higher Education or QS World University rankings, and we see the what is the ranking of the university we are looking. But probably these days you can also see the ranking of the universities subject wise. And in my personal opinion, I feel that not necessarily if the university has a good ranking in overall scores for the university, must be a very good at the subject of your interest. So while choosing the university, I would suggest like probably rather than choosing the university, start looking into the lab of your interest, or maybe a professor or a supervisor who would be the doing work in the interest areas you like. So the same way when I was doing, I wasn't looking for any supervisor. I was looking for their work. So I would say probably if I'm interested in the gut microbiota and I know my target is UK, so probably I'll simply Google or maybe see the publications or research groups who are working into the UK in the gut microbiota. And according to when I get the list of the universities or labs working, among those labs, I will see which professors who are more active, who are having the latest grants, who are producing, making more publications, how many grants or students they have in the lab. So evaluating these factors, I will make a priority list of the professors or maybe the labs I would choose. And mostly, believe me, if you find very active research groups and if they are producing the publications, are fetching good grants from a good funding agencies, that should be your target rather than looking into the larger name of the university ranking. So that is the one way to choose your place where you want to go. Once you see the labs, so again, I would say make a list of the professors, list of the labs, and set a priority for 1, 2, 3, 4. So first start with your first priority. So if you want to go in that place, what are their qualification or eligibility requirements for the admission in that university or that graduate school? Do you qualify all those requirements? Tick mark those. And in addition to that, same time see the what are the scholarships available to study in that university. Because sometimes if you see of the Commonwealth scholarship, you can go to the any university, any subject. Then you go for Chevening scholarship from the UK government, you can go into the any discipline, any university. But sometimes if you're seeing, in case I had chosen the Reading University, so I had another option that the Felix Strux, which also provides scholarship for the Reading University, but may not be for the like Brighton University or Nottingham University. So that way, see your available options of the scholarships as well in that particular institute. Many times, apart from these general national or international or government scholarships, there are many specific scholarships available through the individual institutes as well or other funding agencies as well. So those also give you different alternatives to choose an institute or the lab in your priority list.
The second question from the Omkar. Sir, he is saying that what is the future scope of the study in microbiology rather than in research and teaching?
Okay, broadly, mostly what I know is mostly whatever you do would fall either into research or teaching. But probably I would see the another third area where you can think of is maybe be an entrepreneur. And the entrepreneurship part where you can take into this microbiology area. So, but probably I will see again, even if you're going into the entrepreneurship, that will be backed by some research or something to support your business. I feel that.
I will add in that there is a tremendous scope in microbiology rather than teaching and research. Example, biopharma and bio industries are increasing every day in India. Food industries, tremendously increasing in India. Consultancies. You see, the consultancy is a tremendous scope. And lastly, definitely, what you told is a bio-entrepreneur. In fact, in India, people are ready to work, but they are not ready to give employment to others. Rather than serving industry, you start your own industry and give employment to many others. It is possible. But why it do not happens? I blame only to underestimating ourselves. We are underestimating. You see, Dr. Salunke, you are from village place.
I agree with that.
You are totally from village. But you did your PhD in UK Reading University, one of the best university, and I got a chance to visit that university when you were there. So it is possible if there is a strong determination in mind. That's why I'm very happy that 56 students today have joined and they are eager to know what are the ways, because the process of entry in UK is not a within one day or within 1 week. You have to prepare for 1 year or maybe 2 years also. And that's why there is a tremendous scope.
I would like to just add a little more to the search things now. So as sir mentioned, like actually this is a very important part. Like sir mentioned, like most important bottleneck for progress is our own underestimating ourselves. And this is a very common thing I have seen maybe earlier interacting with the other students also, whenever some people interact with me where they are thinking of like seeking admissions to the higher education. There is a kind of a fear in the students. Maybe they imagine like going abroad or going to the UK, this is something must be a very extraordinary thing, and that must be, we should be the very extraordinary people, or maybe should have very privileged places to be gone through. So I would like to tell you people that definitely this is nothing at all necessary that you should have the privileged background to achieve these things. We've been from very normal places, normal families and everything, and it is very possible. Just you need to believe in yourself, put in very dedicated and I would say most importantly, organized effort.
Next question is from the Pooja Shinde, and she is asking how you got notifications from the lab of interest.
That is also a very important and a kind of challenging thing student feel, because already I have been in touch with many Indian students when I was abroad there, where I was doing a postdoc, and they write me, sir, I had written many professors, I didn't get any feedback. Just imagine or think logically, when you start writing to the professors, so it's not necessarily you apply for 10 professors or you write to them and they will reply you, everybody will reply you. Maybe you need to write 10, 50, 100 or few hundred of professors. Here, importantly, I will tell you like how you can make sure that you get a better replies or you increase chances of getting the feedback from the professors when you write to them. The first thing is also we have to take into account that probably when I was writing to get back my notification back from the supervisor, basically when I'm going abroad, I aim for bigger. We want to have the best place we can get. So the lab I had chosen, the Professor Simon Andrews was the head of the department. He was the director of the research, and he is a senior professor. When you choose a senior professor, they are very well, they have so many other activities and they are very busy with so many things. Probably sometimes their inboxes are so much full that your emails get buried under the load. Probably sometimes when they come back in the Monday morning, they might have a few hundred emails to read through, and maybe your email gets missed. So this kind of things happen. So probably don't get discouraged if you don't get feedbacks. Make sure the first important thing to get a notification, when you write to any supervisor, write a customized email. Don't ever write a same template or same single email to every professor. Okay. These kind of common emails never attract their attention. You don't get attention for these emails and simply they are ignored. So if you are doing this thing, that's a huge mistake, and there are very real chances you will get back any feedbacks. The first important thing is you have to have a customized email to making an emphasis to show that you know the lab, you know what research they are doing, and when you tell about your interest, how your interest align with their interest. Usually relationships build with a mutual interest. Unless and until you are bringing up a mutual interest, some benefit to them and some benefit to you, that's not going to work. So when I say customized email, you get to tell them like, and this and this, highlight your potential qualities that are going to be useful in that lab. Probably if you have a specific technique like maybe microscopy, cell sorting, or NGS technologies, and you already know that lab is doing into the gene sequencing and these things might help to highlight, like you tell, like, I have these techniques, but same time, keep it balanced, because you're not going to work for them. You're going to gain something from them. You're going to learn from that lab. So also bring to their attention that I know this kind of work you're doing in your lab, and this makes me very interested in the topic or research area of your lab. I know these things, but I want to same time develop and enhance these skills which already your lab has. So this makes a clear interaction or clarity of connection for that professor as well. Good labs, you are not the single person applying for that lab. There might be 10, 50 or many applications every day people writing to that professor. It happens. When I was doing my PhD, there will be the deadline for the Felix scholarship. There will be suddenly a pileup of emails coming to the Simon's inbox from the India. Many students say, okay, there is a Felix scholarship. I want to apply. I want to come to your lab. And he used to talk with us because we are there, we have the Felix scholarships. So he used to tell us and talk like there would be many students, they're simply writing in the rush. They see the deadline. Okay, next month there's a Felix deadline, sir. This is my CV. I like your lab. It's very interesting. I want to apply for the Felix. Do you accept me? This is the general mail. That doesn't get their attention. So you have to customize why you are a good candidate. Because if a supervisor wants to endorse you, wants to host you, same time he knows that if you are aiming to achieve a scholarship, scholarships are very competitive. And he would like to endorse the best application or best inquiries coming to him. So this way, if you're customizing the emails, that is the better way to ensure getting a good feedback. Sometimes it happens, you do a very nice customized email and you wait for like a couple of days. Usually I will suggest if you write an email, give at least 3-4 days time. Don't rush to send a reminder. But if you don't get a email back after like 4-5 days, then write in a gentle reminder just to make sure that the professor has received your email. Sometimes if you're sending an email from your personal email, there are chances they might land into their spam inbox. Instead of inbox, they go to into a spam box. So in these cases, it happens that they never know you return to them. So maybe writing an another email, you can ensure that they know that you have sent an email, and they will acknowledge you. And believe me, whenever you write to any professor, if there is any kind of a spark in your writing or your email cover, and that gets their attention, they will usually write you back. If they can't do the needful for you, your application immediately, they will tell, they will reply in a couple of days or something, but definitely they will give a feedback. Sometimes it happens, the professor likes your profile, they are very keen to have you, but probably that might not be the right time of the year, maybe the right time to avail the scholarship, or maybe his lab is already have a plenty of students. He might not be able to support you with the funding. Or maybe that time, particular time, your research area or his research area of the lab doesn't fall into the priority areas decided by the funding agency for that year. For example, the Felix Trust, which I had, they decide the few priority areas for every year. So they decide this year they are going to fund mainly into the agriculture or maybe the biological science or maybe agriculture philosophy or sociology or economics. So that time, these professors, when you mention them, they are aware of these scholarships and the requirements. But same time, remember, if you write to them and if they like you, they will keep you, your profile with them, and maybe they will be happy to get back to you when there are the opportunities to get some funding. So these are the points you need to consider. Another important thing, when I mentioned the professor's emails, could be a lot of emails to get through. So you can, these days with the advancement in the techniques, you have a time to schedule your emails when you want to send it in the Gmail as well. So always remember, when you're writing to any person in the UK, keep in mind a difference into the time zones. Okay. Don't write an email that lands to their inbox somewhere into the midnight, late evenings or some odd times. Probably when you know there is a time difference, keep that time difference in the mind and target that specific time in the daytime to reach their inbox. Never send your emails in the Friday evening, Saturdays or Sundays. If you send your email on the Friday evening, by the Monday morning when the professor comes to the lab and sees his inbox, there will be another 100 emails above your email. So better, even if your email is ready on the Friday, wait for the Monday morning. Send it to the Monday morning around 9:30 something, their time, not your time. So this will be the something, first thing comes to their attention when they open their inbox in the morning. Keep writing to the many professors. Keep writing as many people as you can write.
And the next question is from the Dhruva Chatterjee, sir. Sir, can you tell about the some important government or the national or the other scholarships available at PhD postdoctoral studies?
Regarding the scholarship for PhD, as I mentioned, like probably, I don't know how many of our today's participants know about the British Council in India. So that is one of the very good resource, like britishcouncil.in. That is the website of British Council. That is the official resource from the UK government, and they have the many offices or places in the India. They also have a British Council library as well. That is a very important resource when you are looking to go into the UK, I would suggest. Probably if you open the britishcouncil.in website and then look into the, there is a tab called Study in UK. Under that tab, they have all the further information regarding all the scholarships that are available in UK, all the courses that can be studied in the UK, all the informations. So probably if I tell about the PhD scholarships, the important part about the scholarship is the different types of scholarships are, one is a full funded scholarship that covers your tuition fees, then your living maintenance for every month for the duration of maybe PhD or master's, whatever course, then maybe any other allowances for your requirements. So mainly if some funding agency cover all these expenses, you are all sorted. There is no further burden on you to arrange any further funding. That could be the another opportunity where some institutes or universities, they provide you with the only tuition fees and you have to arrange your own living maintenance. So this is the partial scholarship. So this way, if I say probably nobody would like to go with the half class, probably would like to, everyone would prefer to have the full scholarship. And particularly looking into the UK destination, for the studies of higher educations like masters and PhDs, Commonwealth is very popular, very well known and very well funded option. One. Then another, I mentioned the Chevening scholarship. And I'm not quite sure about the PhD, but definitely that is very good source for the full funding for the masters as well. Then the one I had is the Felix Trust scholarship, which is again a fully funded scholarship. These are the mainly three I knew that is very well funded, that once you get this scholarship, you don't have to think any additional requirements for the money. But apart from these are general widely applicable scholarships. If you look into the individual universities, most of the universities in UK, they also have their own university scholarships as well for the international students. For example, if you say about the University of Reading, they every year offer just only one single scholarship, like fully funded international student. So you can imagine one scholarship for the entire university eligible for all the disciplines. Very, very, very highly competitive scholarship. So remember one thing, when you apply for these general scholarships, the Commonwealth or Felix or these things, you have a better lineage towards you, or more favor, because these are mainly dedicated for specific regions of the world or specific countries or specific targeted developing countries. But when you apply for the institute scholarships, they're open to the worldwide for any candidate and very highly competitive. So when I mentioned about the earlier British Council website, if you look into that website, go to the scholarship page, there are the one is Commonwealth, then another is a great scholarship as well, but I'm not quite sure about the great scholarship. Is it relevant for the biological science or maybe particularly for our life sciences purpose? So, but you can see from the drop-down list on that website, maybe there are one third tab that says like scholarships from the other funding agencies and like university or higher education institutes. That if you see, there would be a list of another 30 to 40 institutional scholarships. And again, going through those scholarships, you can see which university is of interest. Then comes the point, among those list of 30-35, is you see which is the area of interest falls in those universities. If you're looking into same thing, I take like gut microbiota, and where is the gut microbiota in those scholarships? Okay, if you click the gut microbiota, there is a very good collaborative group where I worked in the reading. Probably you might get to see that this group is working very good with the gut microbiota. So when you go with the reading, that group, what's the scholarships? You can go for Commonwealth. You can go for University of Reading scholarship, that is for the international. You can go for the Felix Trust, which is only available at the reading. So these kind of things with the scholarships, you can go. When you don't have much options, or maybe you are not getting through securing these fully funded scholarships, then you can think about going for these partial scholarships, where these institutional scholarships, they can waive your tuition fees. That's also very big, big support. So for example, if a child, when I studied like 7 years back, like started, my annual tuition fees for the research for the PhD was around 23,000-25,000 pound a year. So even this big amount lump sum is being waived, that's a huge support when you don't have full scholarship. So those ways you can try to get like tuition fee waiver from the university, and there you can go for MRD scholarship from like Ministry of Human Resources. These days we call it like education sector on the HRE. There are also plenty of scholarship. Again, that will link you with Commonwealth or other things. But maybe apart from this, I don't know. Another thing I will bring here is like there is another scholarship, I know, like ICAR, I don't know how many people knew about Indian Council for Agriculture Research. They have also started a scholarship for international PhD. So when I say like probably sometimes you have to twist a little bit the things. If you apply straight for a PhD in microbiology, and maybe the ICAR wouldn't fund for like a microbiology into the clinical or other field. But if you link your project of microbiology with the agriculture, you get another opportunity of the scholarship through the ICAR. So be interdisciplinary with your project. Yeah, from India also, apart from in the, there is a scholarship, I don't know the name, but that is to for the students from the scheduled castes or scheduled tribes. That is the another scholarship that allows you to go anywhere in the world. So there are many scholarships. These are also the opportunities when if you belong to the, any of these categories, you can take advantage of these scholarships. They are also very well funded. And so this is regarding the PhD or master's or higher education. Like you can check the list on the British Council as well, or maybe other resources. And apart from this, when we go to the postdoc, mostly I would say for the postdoc opportunities, it is there is a one thing is Marie Curie scholarship is very well funded and very prestigious one, which you can take to the mostly entire European countries or UK or these places. If you're going from the UK, I will say Marie Curie would be the very best scholarship for the postdoc I know very well about. And apart from this, there are not much of the funding I'm sure about the postdoc. But for the postdoc approach, what I have seen is usually postdocs, one thing is when you want to have completely independent your own project, you would like to go for a own funding for a postdoc. So these cases, I don't have a list of the scholarships, but I will tell you like where you can look for how you can work about this. It's probably again start with your research interest, see for the labs that support this research, and interact with those labs with their mutual understanding with your supervisor. They can put your proposal or your application to the best of funding resources, which might not be like available in general for every place, but maybe specifically if you're thinking about the food microbiology group in the University of Reading. This has become a center for European research into food EIT. So probably if you go approach with say Glen Gibson, the food biosciences into the Reading University, and if you put a nice proposal that can attract the funding, these professors can really endorse you into the right funding options. I'm sorry, I don't know much about the scholarships for the postdoc, but I would say this could be the way, like you see your targeted lab and interact with them. Maybe you can write a joint proposal, a joint grant where they can lead, you can become a co-op with them. And not necessarily you have to be a settled faculty here. You can go there and you can be a grant applicant and you can join in there as well.
Thank you, sir. And the next question is from the Kamaljeet.
Sir, actually, I have did my MSc Microbiology in 2016, and then I have done some jobs, and now I want to study more. That is why I have done my LTS. I got 7 band, and now
good.
I have applied biotechnology MSc course at Portsmouth University. So, sir, is it worth it? I have so many confusions.
So, basically, that's a very good start. I would say like you already on the track, you know what you want, you have started the procedure, that's a good, already you are on the track, you are started application. So I would like to ask here, what is your actual confusion here?
Sir, actually it is 1 year course MSc, and I already did MSc in India.
Yeah.
So is it worth, or I will be able to get visa?
The first thing is like we already know when we talk about the masters, usually it is almost 2 years here in India we do the masters. Yeah. When UK it is just 1 year, 12 months. So basically we know that master's course in India is almost 2 years, where we go through good coursework literally for two semesters, then a year's project like that. But when you go for master's in UK, that is really a 1 year course. But at the same time, I would say like many times we think about how come like we spend almost 2 years here and they're just going it in 1 year. Is it really a good course? Is it a quality course? I would say the course is nothing less than anything we do in India. Only this is very intensive course that is packed into 12 months instead of 2 years. So probably one thing specifically talking to Kamaljit, I would say when you already done a master's here, you've been working for say like last 3-4 years in the field now, and that you're quite a mature student now. Probably when I have seen, like when I was doing my PhD, and I had a few Indian friends who were doing masters immediately after the bachelor's. Sometimes they find it very stressful, difficult, because that's very fully packed, intense course we are not used to. It's not about the time frame. It is the content of the course, and we find it a little bit difficult. But when you're going again for masters, I don't think it will be any much difficulty or challenging at your level now. I would like to ask you here, like, is there any specific reason you want to go for masters again, not the PhD?
Sir, actually, I have applied through one agent of IDP, and they told me you cannot directly apply for PhD. And I have applied for several courses in several universities, which were MSc research-based course in medical science, medical biotechnology, applied bioscience. But I got rejection from 2-3 universities because of the research proposal. I don't know how to write research proposal properly, but they said that your research proposal is not matched.
Okay, so for example, I want to just give an insight you here, like why your applications were rejected. You mentioned they said your application research area is not a match. Okay. Yes. So I will highlight again, like when I mentioned it, like write a customized email when you write to a professor. Same thing applies to the admissions or research proposals. So if you are applying for a university and if you write a research proposal, something that really somebody is not really working in those areas, you don't have better chances there. So either you make sure you choose the university and then write a proposal aligning to their research areas. Otherwise, if you want to stick with your own proposal, choose the institute that works in your research area. Definitely, one thing I would say, like if you've chosen a course, assume that you must have seen already the course modules. What are the all modules covered into the course? And appropriately, like when you already have experience working this field, you can really judge the quality of the content and see what you're really going to achieve there, gain a new through that course. And if you see the applications and modules are really interested, there would be definitely a worth giving a go for this course. You will get a master's, you will get an exposure. The only thing, I don't want to interfere anywhere here, but I'm sure like you must be happy with all your funding calculations or everything. Not to going into figures what you have or you don't have, but I just wanted to be aware or ensure yourself that you have very well calculated all the financial things. What actually things are required, how much budget is required, how much they are giving you, how much actually you are planning to get a loan. Is that loan going to give you sufficient amount? Just to make sure, maybe if you want, you can talk to me later about after this session to discuss actually how much calculations are. Just to make sure, like you go with your initial things, you land there And then you would start realizing, okay, I didn't consider this part and this funding is putting you into the stress. You shouldn't be into the stress once you go there because of the money or finances. You should be a free mind to focus on your course.
Very true, you are telling. Now, Nandini wants to ask something.
So, Nandini is asking, which are the main things should be important when I am looking to apply for the PhD or the MSc in UK?
Probably we have talked about this. I will just highlight the same points again. The important points when you are applying for PhD or MSc is, first thing, make sure you know why you want to go there. Okay, sometimes there is just casually people fall into the flow, like along the trend, like some people are applying, I want to go. My friends, be also aware, know the reason actually why you want to go there. Okay, we can talk about this maybe after later, about this elaborate, like why we should go, what actually we are going to get going into the UK, probably not in India. So this is the important thing. And then most important thing when you are choosing, first decide, do you want to do a master or PhD? Okay, there are pros and cons of both things. I don't know what would be your reason, like you want to decide either master's or PhD. So decide first thing what you want to do, either PhD or master's. When you decide both the things, maybe if you do a master's with the coursework, you wouldn't need to write a research proposal, spend a lot of the time. And this could be the probable reason for some people doing master's is they are not have enough time to spend abroad. They don't have enough finances to fund a PhD, because that will be the very expensive part to pay for PhDs if you don't have full scholarship. And also the same time, there is another logical thing here to look into. Like when there are so many funding agencies, we talked about the many scholarships. But see, if you there is charitable trust and they're paying for a scholarship for a student, if they choose a student for master's, they have to fund them for just 1 year. But at the same time, if they choose a student to give a scholarship for PhD, they have to provide a scholarship literally for 3 to 4 years, minimum 3 years, if not 4 years. But basically, if they choose, instead of one PhD, they can give a scholarship for 4 masters. So this is a tricky way. If you just want to go anyhow, get a scholarship and increase your chances of getting a scholarship, master's has a more probability of getting a funding and more funding sources as well compared to the PhD. And apart from this, both of them, you say like you choose the same things. Don't go randomly to any place in any university, just you want to go abroad. Very careful choosing your supervisor and your lab. That is very, very important. For all of you, I would like to emphasize on this thing is that when you want to do a higher education abroad in the UK or anywhere in the world, getting an admission, getting on the flight and landing in the country is not the battle then. Only it is a half or quarter way through. Actual battle starts when you enter there. You're going to spend a very important years, a time of your career there. So don't land into some random lab or random with your random supervisor. And once you go there, you start being unhappy. You start not content with the things happening there. That will be a waste of a lot of efforts, resources, and time, a lot of things. So choose wisely the lab and supervisor. Most important thing when you're going abroad, because there's a lot of investment you're doing. After that, once you do the lab and these things, most important criteria, I will say again, comes your finances. Sort out your scholarship and finances, and same time, keep a very good look onto the qualification or eligibility requirement for the every university you are applying. So admission, mainly falls with the two things: how strong candidate you are with the academics, your qualification. Then comes this English language. So mainly admissions will check two things: your academic records and your English literacy. This is what, as an if I am the university graduate school admissions in charge, I will mainly look for your grades, your English. Okay. But the administrative person will tick mark these questions and he will be happy to process your application for the other steps. But if you're doing for PhD or master's by research, you have also has to choose a supervisor for your project. Okay. So when it comes to the supervisor, is a either way process. When we want to choose somebody, we want to choose the best. Same time when the supervisors want to take any student to the lab, they are also very choosy. They want to have a best candidate. So when it goes to the supervisor, then it comes your capabilities. How you are, how progressive you are. Not necessary if you are applying for MSc, you already have publications. But how already you have been in your field, your grades, your activities, how your writing things are. Even if you haven't published, if there are any other things you have been putting efforts with the writing or any other things, maybe other review things, or your results or the projects you have worked, or maybe the skill set you already have. So these are the other things that doesn't go directly with the admission process, but they equally make an important part in decision making from the professor side. So this is goes with the admission and finances. These are the most important things I would say. And with the visa, I would say that shouldn't be the part you are scared about. So visa is a difficult thing. There is a lot of fear about the visa. Even when I applied, my visa was rejected for silly, unnecessary things. And we are very afraid of it, scared, really scared about it. So with the visa, I would say when you apply for a university, visa in the UK is point-based system. They have points in three categories. The major proportion of points goes to the your sponsorship later, like from the university. So when you get an admission from the university, they give you a CAS number that calls the confirmation of acceptance of studies. Okay. Then the second points comes to your English language eligibility. So that 10 points, I guess, I don't know these days what is the scoring or points system. When I applied, it was probably the language will carry the 10 points. Okay, so you can fulfill this requirement of language points either through your language, like scores, exam scores like IELTS, even they accept TOEFL. That is one way. If you're not doing that, if you don't have, maybe even with the universities, they fall into different grades, like a highly trusted and like categories like A, B, C, like that. And the university you are applying is already into the top trusted with immigration. That university already mentions in your CAS to the immigration, like they have evaluated your English proficiency and that is meets the requirement. That can also be alternative to skip your exam scores and that will give you the 10 points. But you have to make sure it is depends on case by case with the university. So when you actually do the process, university will let you know what is the status, whether they can endorse you this way or you have to produce a code. And third is points comes to your finances. So if you are already have a scholarship and fully funded student, there is a that is very easy process to get a visa because immigration is already satisfied. Your finances are in place and you're not going to put a burden once you are in the UK to their country. So if you are a scholarship, the scholarship later will give you the points. But in case if you don't have all the total full scholarship amount sponsored by the scholarship or the university, and there is a difference that you have to meet, there comes a challenge and the fear. Most of the students will have, maybe in case Kamaljit would be worried about here, this thing. Then you have to show the finances availability to you that you are able to provide that remaining amount of finances. And once you can provide the evidences in the required format, I don't know these days how they accept it, you get those 10 points for the finances as well. And this way you tick mark your point-based system for major three categories like sponsorship, your English, and your finances.
Sir, the next question, it is also very similar from the Rehan. Sir, what are the criteria to get the scholarships?
Okay, yeah, this is actually very important part, and that makes a very a big portion of your entire process, because even if you remember back, I mentioned the if from a personal perspective, I would say going abroad, I would put a major weightage to your scholarship process and the finances in this entire thing. And to get a scholarship, important part is when you're going from India to the another country, you got to think about this few simple things. First thing, why somebody from UK or any government or some people, they want to fund you? What's a benefit for them? What's they are getting these things? Okay, so many places scholarships are to encourage the students, very talented, capable students who are not getting the resources, and to nurture them and provide them a platform. So basically, when this is their objective, you have to think about how I can clearly tell them, show them into the process of their selection, I am the right candidate you should like invest on. So when they want to invest onto the candidate, what they are looking into. So another thing is, like, probably many times students have this confusion. If I studied like a master's like 4 years back, and then I worked for a couple of years, I'm not into the regular education. So does this gap makes me less eligible or less likely to get the scholarship? I would say probably this could be actually go into the advantage for you. I would take this as a favor. How I see this opportunity as a more advantage is like when I have done the master's and I want to apply straight away. So another important thing, when there is a scholarship committee, selection committee or juries, they are looking into your application. They are not looking only as a person like me. They are not looking into Arvind, like what is his score in the master's, what is his score into the BSc, or maybe what is his other achievements, a grade card. Okay, that is a part, but that is already being seen by the university and everybody. So they are not interested into your scores when it comes to the scholarship. What scholarship committee looks into is, going abroad is just not you're going into the classroom, studying, writing exams and coming back. You are going into a completely different foreign land. When you enter into the foreign land, you are going to have so many different new exposures, new things, maybe new challenges or differences you have to acclimatize to, get along with, merge with that system. You're going to face a cultural challenge. If you're talking about the UK, you're going to face a harsh cold weather. Same time, you're going to face a difficulties with like all-time dark gray weathers, very less sunlight. You might be feeling homesickness, staying abroad alone, new people, a new culture, new education system, new working things, completely different ethics in the workplaces. There are so many things. Sometimes that might be a shocking initial shock, a sudden shock when you start there. So same time, the people want to know how versatile, how adjustable as a person, how good you show from your past or previous experiences that you can stand the challenges, you can cope with the adversities, you can suit with the new things, you can adjust and you can progress. This is something, an important thing. If you succeed in showing these things, you can tick mark easily your scholarships. That's also makes a very good part. Alongside your academics, you get an equal weightage for your extracurricular activities, your experience. So these kind of things makes a small additions to the overall scores into the interviews. Probably, I guess personally, for my part, when I had my Felix interview, these other things, extracurricular activities, or maybe showing my background, how I can do these things, really helped me to secure this place. Otherwise, it would have been very challenging for me to just make this scholarship just on the basis of the academics. Why I told this thing is, experience matters is probably when I see the Felix scholarship, I had seen like most of the PhDs who had the scholarship alongside me, either it's Oxford University or SOAS London or the Reading, all my colleagues or the alumni, most of those peoples who had a couple of years or some kind of work experience after their education before they secured the scholarship. So I would say if you have work experience, take it to the advantage to secure the scholarship. Another thing I would like to add here, with the scholarships, I don't know the specific names of the scholarships or things, but in UK and Europe as well, these days, there are some scholarship, most of the scholarship, they encourage the female candidates, students more. All these science scholarships or fundings. There could be, I don't know if there are very specific scholarship only for the female students, but probably when it comes to the competition, they are given a preference. And when it comes to, earlier we talked about the gap between the education, I don't know if we have any scholarship to support for the Indian students to go abroad after a gap. But there was a scholarship kind of a trust or something in UK itself, whether like I had a colleague from Tamil Nadu, but she's based into the UK. She had taken a gap for a family reasons from her continuation from the course. And after that, she wanted to come back into the science research. There are some specific scholarship that are only available to bring back the women who had to take a gap for some or other reasons back into the science.